FS2 at 6 Eastern Time. This is a third place match and arguably more at stake here for the Haitians with a position for them, something they've never been in before. Meanwhile, Canada, they have been here before. More importantly here, Angela, how do these two bounce back after semifinal disappointment?
Well, you said it. I mean, this is a third place match. However, the teams in the final have already secured their spot for the World Cup. This match, however, they are still looking for that final spot. And Haiti's already beaten Canada in group play, so let's see what happens today.
Third place on the line and a spot at the 2016 Under-17 Women's World Cup. Happy to have you along. Haiti, of course, going from left to right in the blue and Canada in the white. Canada coming off that disappointing 5-0 thrashing on Friday in the semifinal. Haiti trounced 3-0 by Mexico. Both of these two looking for brighter fortunes today as it comes out wide on the near side for Canada's Anissa Ibrahim. Even though these two very familiar with each other, expecting to see a little bit of a different tactical setup early on, Angela.
Well, both of these teams are actually flooding the midfield with a ton of players. There are 10 players in that midfield with a 4-5-1 look from Haiti and a 4-3-2-1 look from Canada. So the way that they're going to find success is getting in behind that midfield, looking behind the defense, getting the ball wide, and really looking to possess.
Shek Borkowski. Last Monday when they went against the Canadians and got that come-from-behind win. Played 4-4-2 against the Canadians, 4-3-3, going a little bit more defensive, as you mentioned, by necessity, by way of an injury to Mirkaline San-Felix, who went out with an ACL injury on Friday. Very disappointing for her. And of course, that leads to the one change in the lineup as Elwa Sant is introduced. A different role today for Mondesir, dropping deeper.
And that really should be interesting to see how Mondesir can really lead her team with St. Felix being out of the lineup here. And also the effect of how everyone's feeling emotionally by losing a player of that caliber in such an important match today.
Bev Priestman, you just saw the Canadian manager, said she was very frustrated, found it difficult to play against a team like Haiti that likes to sit back and counterattack. We'll see if they can figure out the jigsaw puzzle today. And got off to a good start here. Near side for Anissa Ibrahim. The 17-year-old pulls it across. Haiti in some defensive difficulty early. And finally get the clearance away.
And that's definitely going to be key for Canada. I'm sure Coach Priestman has already talked to her players about finding a way to also stay positive. It can be very frustrating when you're having so many players in the midfield.
This one finds its way once again to Ibrahim. Good looking cross, but no one arriving in time. Canada absorbing a lot of this attacking pressure early on from the Canadians. For the first time since 2008, are not in the Under-17 CONCACAF final. Uncharted territory for them, but still within a chance to qualify for their fifth consecutive Under-17 Women's World Cup. Get a good look at Emmeline Charles, who played every minute. And that defense is really going to have their hands full with this Canadian attack.
And that's another thing that could also play a factor in this game. These players have played a lot of minutes. This is at the end of the tournament, so how will fatigue be managed? Are they able to really manage the fatigue, making sure their legs are still fresh when they need them?
Going back to the Haitian goalkeeper, Kelly Teus, a nimble presence. One clean sheet, that in the first match against Grenada when they won out 13-0.
Just nice job and recognition of Teus coming off the line to hold on to that ball.
The experience of Canada and the inexperience of Haiti, but undaunted. Trying to qualify for their first ever Under-17 Women's World Cup. Haitian football has made such great strides. Finished last in their group back in 2013 at the CONCACAF Under-17 Championships, just behind Jamaica, Mexico, and El Salvador. And play it up top, and that will force the Canadian goalkeeper Poole to come way off her line.
You already see Mondesir's effect getting that ball defensively winning it back in the midfield, playing that up top, and also getting everyone else involved here up front. She needs to be very active, being the sole forward in the attack.
Switched over here to the near side and comfortably headed away by the Haitian defense. Content to absorb this pressure. They've been very impressive off the ball. And played in the right-hand corner now. And on the gallop is Shanna Flynn for Canada, asking perhaps a bit too much of the Canadian winger. Andy Deschamps attending to her duties in the back. Canada taking care of Guatemala to start the tournament before a 7-0 thrashing of Grenada and a disappointing loss, surprisingly so, on Monday. Free kick here for the Haitians after their big win against Grenada, which, by the way, set a single-game scoring record for the most scored at 13-0. Followed that up with a win against the Guatemalans before that victory over Canada.
And I don't think this is going to be any different in the rest of this game. Some physical play. Canada is very known for their physical play, and I think Haiti will match that as well.
Canada comfortable in possession with a strong start here early on, asking the questions. A gap in midfield, up and over the top, and once again, Teus coming off her line. Lacked a bit of conviction, however, and it will come out of play. Waitima bearing down on the Haitian goal. Flynn. Lovely skill from the Canadian winger, however. Just over hitting that cross. You get a good look at the Haitian coach, Shek Borkowski.
This is a very nice job by Teus coming off her line here. She does slide with her feet, but that is a very dangerous opportunity for Canada. And potentially lucky that she didn't actually get called against for that one.
Canada able to vary their attacking approach. They can possess. However, they do have the option of going the direct route as well. Flynn just trying to link up with Vital Katz. One of those two changes played inside, and a lovely hit and a super save from Kelly Teus. Just enough to deny Jordan Waitima.
Waitima's been very active already so far. Look at how she gets in behind the defense. And Teus comes up huge with that save. She's really keeping Haiti in this game right now. Canada could have easily had a couple goals by this point.
First corner of the afternoon. And to be taken by Ashley Cathro. It goes short. There it goes down inside the box. And Karen App, the American referee, not at all interested. This is Julia Grosso for Canada. Up and over the top. Waitima is in. The nod is on. Just not enough power to get past Teus. Bev Priestman here, Angela, has to be pleased with what she's seen in the first 8 minutes.
Absolutely. And again, two players unmarked on the back post. Haiti needs to be careful about this. Waitima is very open, is not able to get enough power to beat Teus. But again, very dangerous attacks so far by Canada.
Some nervousness back there for the Haitian defense, which has only been breached three times in their four games in this tournament. I'll give you an idea of how far Haitian football / soccer has come. Their six prior games before this tournament started had not resulted in a victory, but Shek Borkowski turning that around on match day one here in the Caribbean. Strong start really led to positive performances against Guatemala, as well as that win over Canada.
And Coach Borkowski has told us their goal coming into this tournament is to secure that third place spot. They want to come out at least in third, and they have an opportunity to do that today.
Here's Grosso with a fine looking cross. Teus once again gets the gloves to it. The 17-year-old who plays her club soccer, Agile Briand, part of that training center set up in Port-au-Prince. Canada once again, wave after wave, this time played over for Ibrahim, squares it across, but no one making that near post run. And Haiti really will want to collect themselves here and get some composure.
Yeah, Haiti just seems a little bit frantic right now. Again, not really picking up their players. Wide open and having so much time and space. You see here, Ibrahim has so much time to look up and pick out a spot, isn't able to connect fully with it. But Haiti needs to win the balls in the midfield and really help to get some more attacking presence right now in this game.
Canada with the one under 17 qualification championship to their credit back in 2010. They managed to dispatch of Mexico in Costa Rica. This is Nahida Balbaki. Another one of those two changes from the team that lost to the Americans. Played across for Ibrahim, who arrives on the edge of the box. And while Canada are getting some good penetration, the finishing leaving just a little bit to be desired.
And we can see here too, again, probably went out of bounds, but they didn't call that one. But in the last match that Haiti and Canada played, Canada actually had 60% of the possession to Haiti's 40%. So they possessed the ball very well and for the majority of time. However, as you mentioned, the quality of their opportunities and the quality of their finishing just was not there.
Shauna Flynn dropping into a deep roll, going the direct route. And once again, Tay is called into action. No doubt about the Haitian approach. With 10 behind it and absorbing a lot of this Canadian pressure.
That's an excellent call and recognition there by the lines person.
There is experience for this Haitian team. 9 players played a part for the Haitians back in 2013 in the under-17 qualification phase. And a rare foray into the Canada half as this one's played up by Mondesir, trying to locate the likes of Lovely Pierre to no avail. This is Flynn.
And that's where Haiti's really going to need to concentrate. With only one player up top, here's the lone striker. She needs to be able to get the ball either at her feet and hold on to it so that the rest of her teammates can get up and support her in the attack.
Shane Borkowski saying he expects Canada to be just a little bit more patient than they were last Monday. They came out in that 4-3-3. Being very aggressive early on, but a chance now for Haiti to put a dent of this Canadian defense. Good storming run out of the back by Maria Mondesir, but upended by the Canadian defense. That's one of the adjustments you and I were talking about off-air. Mondesir having to drop into a midfield role just to negate the strong presence in the Canadian central midfield.
And we see it's Alessant here, who tries to take on two Canadian players. It's a little bit slippery and wet, but good try. There's not a whole lot of support in the attack right now because of their tactical shape.
Pierre in support now. Better spell this from Haiti, but a little misguided in the end. Ev Priestman, a rising star in women's soccer right now, the 29-year-old from England, in charge of the last qualification phase, working very closely with senior team head coach John Herdman. Here's Balbaki. Waitima plays it across. Ibrahim is in, and a sliding last-ditch challenge by Haiti. Once again, the Haitian defense flirting with disaster.
Yeah, it's definitely putting a lot of pressure on them right now. And again, it's going to be how they take advantage of the opportunities that they get in order to really get that goal, because they can possess against Haiti. Haiti's sitting back a lot, but will they finish on their opportunities?
And Haiti with a defender and some injury difficulty. Emily Charles still down, and play continues on as the referee hasn't called a stop to it. And finally, it will come out for a throw. Charles injured on that challenge against Ibrahim moments ago. She's been one of the bedrocks in that Haitian defense for Sheck Borkowski.
Yeah, let's see if we can take a look here. She does an excellent job of just getting to that ball, but it looks like she got her ankle or foot stepped on as she went in for that slide tackle. Ibrahim looks like she just steps on her foot as Charles goes down to save and clear that ball out of danger.
Charles, who also plays it, Ugly Briand, just inside Port-au-Prince. Such a tight-knit group for Haiti. A national training center with about 60 players. They've called the atmosphere, quote-unquote, a family type of atmosphere, unquote.
And Charles has been one of the players that has played every minute for this Haitian team, so she is definitely someone that hopefully is okay and can continue to play for this team.
A chance now for Borkowski to readjust. And Charles really shouldered the brunt of that challenge. Look at the possession, overwhelming share of it for Canada. It really kind of tells the story right now.
Yeah, I mean, those are huge numbers for Canada. And again, we need to see the ball in the back of that. I know Coach Bev has told them that they need to capitalize on their opportunities, because in the last game, it wasn't good enough. And this is for that final spot. So again, Canada's creating wonderful opportunities. They just need to stay patient and look for that final goal.
And Shanna Flynn. I see us at the center of the park now. Comes out wide for Serafina Joseph, just shouldered off by Flynn. Bev Priestman, the Canada coach, says she was really looking forward to that match against the United States. Thought it would be a little bit more open, and that plays to the Canadian strengths. In the end, it didn't turn out in their favor, however. Positive news for Haiti, meanwhile. There's the look that Charles is going to come back on.
This is for that last spot for the World Cup. If she's the type of competitive athlete that I know she is, she's going to be back on that field in no time.
Sarah Stratagakis, calming presence in the center of the park. An orthodox touch there from Teus. Pretty confident with her feet. It seems to be the prerequisite these days with goalkeepers in that modern style. Here come Canada once again, this time behind Vital Katz. Good hold-up play from Haiti's lovely Pierre. She'll need some support here as this comes out directly forward. Perhaps a little bit too early, but calm and composed is Canada's Julia Grosso.
And just that ball's just played really direct. It needs to be pulled out wide a little bit. Again, there's so many players in the middle of the field. Haiti should use the width a bit more and really find some space to open up in the middle.
They do have the pace to unhinge this Canadian defense. They'll try and use it this time on the right. And once again, it's a strong little run from Elwassant. Hit by the robust challenge on the left-hand side of that Canadian defense. Albaki scooping it up. Waitima, who's dropped into a deeper role, play it wide on the right-hand side for Emma Reagan. Talking about the flanks for Haiti, but Canada like to get their fullbacks or outside backs involved going forward as well.
Absolutely, and they're finding the right space, just the technical ability just needs to be a little bit crisper and cleaner. We just saw two balls played up in the air. That's definitely harder to control and actually do something a little bit more quickly once you get the ball.
Haiti trying to get some more touches for Maria Mondesir. Already with a few senior team caps under her belt.
That's a little bit deceptive, actually, for Haiti. About half this team has had the opportunity to already play for their full national team. So they are actually going into these games not very fearful. Montessier has already said she doesn't get scared or afraid playing these 17 games.
Meanwhile, Flynn trying to locate the likes of Waitima Ibrahim arrives in support. Canada relieve the pressure. Reagan's cross, and out comes Teus with the punch. A little more conviction that time from the Haiti goalkeeper, who did well. Here's Pierre now, a chance to take on all comers. It's a 1v4 situation. And foul charge against the Haiti striker.
Well, you can see how quickly things change. Teo's coming off her line to get that ball out. And Pierre at the other end, as you said, taking on four players. Only person, and it just seems like there's really not any contact there, but the referee's going to call it the other way.
Talked about the experience. Nine players involved in that last qualification cycle. A lot of players have played against the USA and Mexico in the past for this Haitian team. Speaking of which, we'll have the final a little bit later for you at 6 p.m. right here on FS2. You can join Mark Robodino and Kendra de St. Alban with the call. Both of those two, of course, already assured of a spot at the Under-17 Women's World Cup in Jordan, beginning in late September, and another player down. Meanwhile, for Haiti, it's Naphtali Norte.
It's just very physical, hard tackling, but Norte almost sets herself up for the possibility of getting hurt here. With, you can just see her ankle, and her foot is actually sliding in to the player.
A couple of injury worries. Moments ago, Charles, and now Norte.
Norte, that's how she plays. She's an extremely physical, hard, tough player, and that's just what you know you can expect from her.
Started all four games up to this point for Haiti. She'll have to come off momentarily, and temporarily Haiti down to 10 women. Expected to see some physical play. It's definitely been rough and tumble in the first 22 minutes. Experience such a valuable asset at this young level. USA senior team and Mexico senior teams, as well as the Colombian senior teams, have seen some of these under-17 Haitian players. It's really served them well this time around. In fact, a lot of these Haitian players going against the United States senior team in matches last September in the United States.
Absolutely. This experience just in this tournament is so great for some of these players, and then to have the experience of playing with and against a full team, full national team level, I mean, that just helps you grow as an individual and as a player.
Captain Montessier upended. So the Haitian players coming out and publicly saying, hey, we used to be scared of playing the big teams like Canada, like the United States, but we're no longer so-called soccer tourists. We're competitors.
Absolutely.
And it's beginning to show.
Yeah. And again, just we're going to see, I think, a lot of physical, tough, hard play from both of these teams.
So another free kick here for the Canadians. Trying to draw first blood in the third place game. Waitima and Ibrahim amongst the targets, flicked in, and a dangerous moment back there for Haiti. Canada throwing all their firepower behind that set piece.
And looking here for Stratagakis. And again, Haiti having a difficult time coming up with a save, but it looks like Teus heads that ball away from danger. That is a phenomenal save. Not sure how intentional it was, but however she can get that ball away from danger, she does it. And I've been very impressed with how Teus has been playing so far.
Not sure how much she knew about it. They'll take this one low. Disappointing. As the Haitian defense not at all fooled. One last off the Canadian captain, Sarah Stratagakis.
And this is, I think, one of Haiti's weaknesses is just the set pieces right now, having difficulty really seeing the ball and the player at the same time. They need to be a lot closer to their marks.
One taken low and rehearsed right off the training ground, but it didn't quite come off. Happy to have you along for the Under-17 Women's Championship third place match here in St. George's, Grenada, in the beautiful Caribbean. Haiti and Canada trying to bounce back after disappointing semifinal defeats. Alongside Angela Hughes, I'm Christian Miles. We've seen a lot of chances here early from Canada. Still no end payoff, a testament to this Haitian defense. And this one floated to the far post where Anissa Ibrahim was waiting. Canadians continue to bear down, and that one goes well high.
And again, Ibrahim was sitting there in the middle of the field there in the goal, just waiting for the ball. Nobody was on her. Haiti needs to be a lot more mindful of picking up their marks on crosses and on set pieces. That could come back to haunt them later on.
Contrasting tactical styles between the English manager of Canada and the Polish boss of Haiti. Also, nowhere to go. Haitima waiting for that through ball to no avail. Haiti looking much more comfortable defensively than they did in the first 10 minutes. Ibrahim. A careless ball in the center of the park, and here comes Haiti, only too happy to oblige. It's come out into a wide roll, and here they come. Mondesir looking for some support and some options. Good strength from the number 10. Twisting and turning, she slipped in behind. Mondesir still going. The Canadian fence just unable to dispossess the number 10. Sensational effort. Not a lot of end product.
Mondesir has just some individuality here, taking on two Canadian players. And actually, Ibrahim comes over to help defend, but then she leaves her alone. And Mondesir, again, just trying to do whatever she can. That is what Haiti needs right now, is for her to come up and really play more of that attacking role and support Pierre up in the offense.
And Mondesir, part of the Haiti team, participated in the 2013 CONCACAF Under-17 qualifiers down in Jamaica. Chef Borkowski saying he's going to need her presence, her calming presence, in the center of midfield. It's a battle that's been won thus far by Canada. The switch from Grosso. This is Samantha Chang. Had the run of Flynn. Good control now. Mondesir awaits for the support on the right-hand side. This is more positive as Elwassant arrives. Good-looking cross, but just a little bit too strong for lovely Pierre. Chance for Haiti to build something substantial, though. Mondesir, the captain, direct now. I have to say it was expertly read by the Canadian defense, and a chance for the women in white to counterattack.
And this is the strategy that Haiti wants to have. They're fine with being compact and making it difficult for Canada to really create some offense, and then trying to find a way to get up into the attack. I don't think we're going to see them having a lot of opportunities, but if they're able to capitalize on the ones that they get, then Canada could be in trouble. Especially seeing at all of the opportunities Canada has had already, and they have not been able to convert against Haiti.
Now down goes lovely Pierre. Up and over the top. The target that time was Canada's Jordan Waitima. Only 14 years of age. Already with two goals to her credit in the tournament. You see Borkowski saying, hey, let's up the tempo and put some pressure on this Canadian defense. Mondesir, gonna go the direct route for Pierre.
And they're trying to use Pierre's speed up top. She is quick and she's fast. And they're just trying to get that ball up to her into space to beat the Canadian defense. They just need to pull the ball a little bit, give her more of an opportunity to actually run in behind the defense of Canada.
Well, it's a Canadian defense that is yet to be tested. You see Yampoul yet to make a save in the Canadian goal. Mabassir forging away in the center of the park. A combative spirit starting to reveal itself is Melissa Dacius, lending her expertise in the center of midfield.
And again, just good, hard, physical play, and also just individuality from Dacius there, trying to do something, create some more offense for her team.
Dacius had the winner from the penalty spot against this very same Canadian team on Monday. After Mondesir was fouled on the 84th minute by Kennedy Faulkner, that really breaking Bev Priestman and the rest of this Canada team's hearts. Not accustomed to losing at this level. They've only experienced defeat on five occasions in 23 games at the under 17 qualification level.
When you're holding on and possessing the ball that much, you have that much of the ball, it's very demoralizing. You kind of have that expectation that you're going to win. So that was deflating for Canada. And again, already Canada, we are seeing over 70% of the possessions so far in this first half. Is it going to be good enough?
Karen App telling Dacius to cool it. Dacius is getting into it. A little bit of afters there, as they say, with Vital Katz. Nothing too serious. Once again, 10 behind it for Haiti as it pops out wide for Canada's Julia Grosso. Looking to make some inroads on the left. Good change of pace as she flicks one in. Good looking cross, but it was going to be tough to generate power to beat the keeper.
And Katz was standing in the center. And nice just flank play here. Good cross, however, just hard to get power when you're standing and not really running on the ball. Balbaki tries to get ahead on it, just not enough strength there.
Balbaki already the goal against Grenada in the second group stage match. And another tackle this time. We've seen Norte get involved. This time she gets a piece of Waitima. The referee looks as though she might go to the pocket. Yet to deal a yellow and reticent to do so.
This is a dangerous opportunity for Canada. Again, Waitima comes in very, very hard tackle and also repeats her up. So I think that's an excellent call. It's a very dangerous play. Excellent call by the referee there.
Does win the ball, but clears out Waitima in the process and puts Haiti in a little bit of a precarious spot right now. Dead ball arising for Canada, and Samantha Chang. So a one-woman wall for Rosaline Elwasant. Can Chang find the supply line? That is the question. Now they'll have to retake this one. Elwasant a little too mobile there on the line, and Chang will retake it.
Yeah, it was a little confusing. Chang actually made that pass before the referee blew the whistle.
So the restart now. Canada posed some difficulty earlier. Can they do it again? They once again keep it low. Flynn arrives, drops it back. Katz thought about it. And once again, Haiti survive. An interesting approach. We've seen these corner kicks taken low, and we once again see it on the free kick.
I think it's a missed opportunity for Canada, not just in that, but also the aerial balls have been more successful for them, and it just disrupts Haiti's defense a bit. There are no Canadian players running into that space where Chang played the ball.
They've asked all the questions, Canada. Haiti have had the answers thus far.
It's almost the intensity level seems to have dropped a bit since the beginning of the match as well. I think that's definitely playing a factor into the score line right now. I think that's why we saw Shep Borkowski kind of just trying to motivate his team and using his arms like, okay, let's pick this up a bit right now.
so tiring when you're chasing the majority of the time and absorbing that pressure. No doubting the fitness here of this Haitian team, which have been a revelation, the Cinderella story, the under 17 level. Nice little run directly played in for Ibrahim, and once again, timely intervention on that back line by Emmeline Charles. This will be a real test of Canada's ingenuity and ability to break down a resilient defense.
It's tough. This is a tough defense to break down when you're that compact and you have five players in the midfield. Canada just needs to be very patient and not get frustrated, because it can be very frustrating just looking for those opportunities to break down this Haitian team.
Maria Mondesir. Knocked down by Katz. Such a great story about Mondesir. Spotted when she was 12 years of age by Coach Borkowski. She was playing one-on-one against her brother at a market, helping her dad sell bananas, because her father is a banana farmer.
Yeah, Mondesir is actually a judo athlete. She'd never even played soccer at the time when she was discovered by Chef Borkowski.
Right-hand side, and here they come behind Emma Reagan. You know, not a lot of organized experience. They learn the technical aspects, a lot of street soccer, if you will.
And Canada using that width and just trying to get crosses out wide. And they set themselves up for an opportunity here.
Now Canada getting set for their fourth corner. See what is in the offing here. They've kept it low. They've got the tall timber, and they keep it high this time over the head of Stratigakis. A resounding response as it's thumped in. Once again, lacking in accuracy from Vital Katz.
Again, I just think it's just the technical ability right now. Just needs to be a little bit sharper for Canada. And see Coach Priestman just kind of rubbing her eyes there in a little bit of frustration.
Haiti looking much more organized than we saw in that shaky first 10 minutes. Nissa Ibrahim trying to pick the lock. This is Grosso. And Flynn tucks inside. Here it might have been a handball spotted by the referee's assistant.
Yeah, it just looks like the ball bounces up to Flynn's arm and assistant referee catches that.
Perhaps some building frustration right now from Canada. So far, so good for Haiti. You've really taken everything that the Canadians have thrown at them thus far.
And give credit to goalkeeper Teus there, back saving early on some critical opportunities for Canada, really keeping Haiti in this match. She's playing very well. She sometimes can be a little bit shaky and indecisive off her line, but she's been very focused and disciplined today.
Far side. Canada haven't had a lot of success on that flank. They'll square it for Stratigakis, but a little overcooked in the end. And Mondesir onto it in a flash. Good strength there from the number 10. And here come the Haitians. Once again, just when they have some promise, doesn't come quite fulfilled. But that's ambitious, to say the least, as she saw the keeper off her line.
Well, Mondesir just using her strength and body to win the ball, and I think she's trying to pull a little Carly Lloyd action here with that halfway shot, and she almost makes it. It hits the top of the crossbar. She'd be winning if it's the crossbar game.
That would have been the goal of the tournament, that's for sure. And Mondesir saying she's actually inspired by Carly Lloyd.
That's right, Carly Lloyd, her favorite female, and Messi, her favorite male player.
Here's Stratigakis, picks the pass, Ibrahim! Eventually held a tame effort in the end.
I'm Ibrahim, I want that one back. She's had so many opportunities so far, and that is a missed opportunity for Canada. Lovely ball played in and just doesn't connect. She has a great angle to really slot that one home, far post, bending it around. Teus just missed opportunity. Challenging effort. Ibrahim just undercutting. Haiti gets the call.
Now we look at the shots. Haiti, they average nearly 16 per game, just three. That more a reflection of the tactical setup against this Canadian outfit.
And not surprising at all, seeing that they've been a lot more defensive minded in this game and having only Pierre as the only forward up top.
Ibrahim. Dropping deep is Waitima in the Haitian half, trying to locate Flynn. Good interception now. Maria Mondesir has Pierre in front of her, slips around one. Mondesir, lovely skill, but nicely read in the back by Canada's Ashley Cathrop. A little bit discombobulated, but can cover up well enough in the end. Seen this defensive approach. Do you expect to see it to continue for Haiti, Angela?
I think so. I think they've come out in pretty much all the games in this tournament so far, a very similar style and approach, and it's been working for them. So I would expect to see that. Mondesir starting to push up a bit more, helping to support Pierre up top. If they can continue to do that, then they can start to potentially create some opportunities, get that goal in while Canada's sleeping.
It's been a big ask for the Haitian striker, Lovely Pierre, largely uninvolved. Shek Borkowski beginning to think about that halftime team talk, I'm sure. And weather the early storm. Grosso. Good 1v1 here, and Canada get themselves tied up in knots as Cathro dueling it with Lovely Pierre. It's going to go against the Haitians.
Well, I think that's tremendous from Pierre. Look at how hard she's working to get this ball and just trying to do whatever she can, create some attack here. And that's all Cathro can do to just hold on and wait for that whistle to blow.
Now this one, the first of our doubleheader. Make sure you join us after this one. It's the Under-17 Women's Championship Final. As Mexico gets set to take on the United States, you can join Mark Rogodino and Kidder to St. Alban at 6 p.m. right here on FS2. Those two, of course, already assured of a spot in the 2016 Under-17 Women's World Cup. The third and final spot going to either Haiti or Canada. So much on the line in this third place match. Flynn. Emma Rega coming forward from that right back position. Puts it on that left foot. Ibrahim with a high challenge. It was a dangerous one at that. The referee did reach for the card, and she may have cautioned the Canadian midfielder. It was a high and dangerous boot. Shortage of physical play. This is confirmation that it is a yellow card, the first of the afternoon against Canada's Anissa Ibrahim.
And it was good defensive effort. Again, Ibrahim's foot is just extremely high. Dangerous play and a nice call by the referee there. Haiti's actually lucky that that was called because there was another Canadian player unmarked right behind Ibrahim.
El Wassant. A chance for a brief water break. Haiti not afraid to mix it up with this strong Canadian team that's been renowned for years about their pace and their power. So far, so good. The Caribbeans have gone toe-to-toe. Here's Katz. Trying to slip it in behind for the awaiting Ibrahim. Haiti with a chance to build something out of the back. Now Wassant trying to go the direct route, as we've seen all too often.
Yeah, if that ball is played just up and over, it gives Pierre a chance to really use her speed and try to beat the Canadian defense.
Perhaps just a little bit more patience necessary. Here's Ashley Cathro. Plays a club soccer with the Vancouver Whitecaps up in British Columbia. Hasn't been called into action on too many occasions. Vital Katz, who scored against Guatemala, become more involved and operate in that supporting role just behind the attackers.
This Canadian team has seen basically a different lineup in every game. Their bench is extremely deep. It's actually been a very good problem for Coach Priestman.
A confirmation there will be at least 2 minutes of added on time.
You see another high kick there by Haiti. Dumournay.
Youngest player on the team. Believe it or not, Coventina Dumournay. The reason they call her Baby as her nickname, she's only 12 years old. Unbelievable. As this one's floated in, with a nice trajectory to it. Ibrahim dwelling perhaps a little bit too long on the ball. Interesting point there. We mentioned that Dumournay being 12, not the youngest player in the tournament. Grenada actually fielding a 10-year-old in the group stages.
Just a tremendous opportunity for these young players to get experience at this level. But she might be 12 years old. She doesn't play like a 12-year-old.
That's for sure. Dumournay has been a constant for Shek Borkowski. She scored against Grenada, played every minute in this tournament. Testament to her ability and maturity.
She is not shy. She's very vocal and actually has a lot of respect for her teammates.
Stratagakis now playing it wide, but seen too nicely by Serafina Joseph. Just enough to ward off the challenge from Canada's Emma Reagan. The final minute of stoppage time. Canada would love to sneak one in here just before the break. Good chance to do so. Reagan's throw by Tima. Well closed down. Here's Balbaki. Has that attempt block. Here's Julia Grossa around one. Plays it across. Stratagakis trying to get the shot off, but the Haitian defense able to respond in kind. 2 minutes is up, and that's going to do it. Enterprising start. Canada piling on the pressure early on. Haiti able to weather the storm, but plenty to talk about for both Bev Priestman and Shek Borkowski. Halftime, Haiti 0, Canada 0.